Hey guys, Manu with Yumi here, where I talk about anything and everything related to money and how to grow your wealth. Today I want to share with you guys few reasons of why I'm not investing in the Singapore stock market and some of the reasons of when and why I would. Alright, so let's get right into it. When it comes to the Singapore stock market, the market cap is so small compared to the US market, right? It's a no-brainer, right? Singapore is tiny, it's like half the size of LA City, and the US is just a huge country. It's the third largest country in the world with the highest GDP. And most of the cutting-edge technologies and innovative companies were started in the US. Major hedge funds around the world are focused on buying into the US stock market. Why? It's arguably the largest in the world until maybe when China takes over in the next 20 to 30 years. Let's take a look at the world's top 50 most innovative companies. Over half of them are US companies, right? Apple, Google, Amazon, and Microsoft. If you look at UOB, they are a 30 plus billion dollar market cap company. And if you don't know, any company that is $10 billion or more is considered to be large cap. So by definition, UOB is a large cap company. But when you compare UOB Bank to the top few banks in the US, UOB seems to be like the size of a baby. JP Morgan Chase, one of the banks I'm banking with, is trading at a market cap of over $400 billion. That's more than 10 times of what UOB is trading at. And even Citibank, one of the hedge fund's least favorite bank stock, is trading at a market cap of $100+ billion. And market cap is important because it tells you the price that people are willing to pay for the stock. Personally, I think US stocks have more opportunities because the market is more volatile, which gives more buying opportunities, and higher risk equals higher rewards, right? What that means, for example, is when people react to the news and cause the stock to swing upwards or slide downwards. And that's why pump and dumps are more likely to happen in the US. Look at GameStop, for example. That's probably never going to happen in Singapore. Of course, when there are winners, there are losers. You don't want to be on the wrong side of this. This is probably why most of the day traders I know are trading in the US stock market. I do like some volatility in the stock market, especially when I'm trying to build out new positions in my portfolio. So, for example, if I have $100,000 to invest, I'm not going to put all of that money into one stock. I'm going to spread it out and buy a few stocks which I have the highest convictions. And for me, it will be companies I feel are undervalued but have a high chance to reach their full potential, or companies with attractive risk rewards. And I try not to time the market. I buy at market value, but I do not buy all at once, and build my position over time. And right now, in the longest running bull market in history, I'm more interested in small cap stocks rather than large cap stocks because I feel there are more opportunities with small cap stocks. And this brings me on to my next point of finding hidden gems in this widely overvalued stock market. Let's take a look at the Russell 2000 for small caps and Russell 3000 for large caps. Look at the graph, right? It's at its all-time high. And there's no doubt that we're in a bubble. Let's take a look at another chart, which is the margin debt. And this is a chart that shows how many people are borrowing money to be in the stock market. It's another all-time high. The Coconana pandemic did very little to stop the bull run. Of course, you can factor the US Fed's printing money and pumping it into the market as part of the reason why the stocks kept going up. So the million-dollar question now is, when will the bubble burst, or if it will even burst at all? And back to my point, because the US market is so huge, it is easier to find undervalued stocks, which I feel are mostly small-cap stocks right now, which are not even on Wall Street's radar yet. So if you buy it before Wall Street does, and when they do, the price is just gonna go up, up, up. There's plenty of room for growth for a new company in the US to expand to different cities, states, and possibly overseas expansion. While the Singapore stock market is generally undervalued, not many people are trading and buying Singapore stocks. So for me to find a stock in the SGX that can 2x, 3x, or 10x my money over time is going to be a whole lot more difficult. My next point is flexibility. When buying Singapore stocks, some companies will require investors to buy a minimum of one lot or 100 shares, while for US stocks, you can just buy one share. So if a stock is trading in the SGX for $10 a share and they require you to buy a minimum of 100 shares, you'll have to fork out $1,000 to own a piece of that company. But with US stocks, if the stock is trading at $10, you can just buy one share. This is better for people who are just starting out in the stock market and don't have much funds to invest or lose, and then try to build that confidence and experience before going all in into the stock market. In my personal portfolio, I own very little Singapore stocks. It's not even 10% of my entire portfolio. And I've never really considered buying Singapore stocks because the prices are just so stagnant, it's hard to 2x, 5x, or 10x my money. But when the market took a hit last March because of Coconana, I saw it as my window of opportunity and bought a few stocks. But I'm looking to sell as soon as it reaches anywhere close to my target price. And one of the first few stocks that I bought was Singapore Airlines. I bought it at $3. And it wasn't even at its lowest. It went all the way to like $2 something. And 1 year later, it's at $5 something here today. Singapore Airlines was one of the few stocks I did not have to do a deep dive into the financials and just bought into it. And yes, maybe I'm biased, but Singapore Airlines has always been an innovator in the airline industry with its suites class, both the chef service and the customer service is top notch. They've also consistently won awards, always in the top 10 best airline in the world, and Singapore Airlines is the pride of Singapore, right? Since it's our national airline. And if you want to know, maybe you don't, but Singapore Airlines is the only airlines I'll fly if I'm flying back to Singapore from LA. And I don't care about the price, even if it's cheaper to fly by another airline like ANA, which oftentimes it is. And I feel like as a Singaporean, if I can support a local brand or a company, I'll do it. Just like I own the Razer lens head mouse to support a Singaporean owned tech company. Great mouse for gaming. I've won many Apex Legends games with it. With Singapore Air, you have to know that it's not the cheapest flight out there. There's plenty of other airlines that offer cheaper flights to Singapore. So why do I still choose to fly SQ? Well, basically it's brand loyalty, and honestly, it just makes me feel at home whenever I fly Singapore Air. It's like when you land in Singapore and the cabin crew says, "To all Singaporeans, welcome home." It just warms up my heart and makes me feel fuzzy, and I don't care if you think I'm weird, but for my next trip home, I'm still flying Singapore Air. I also bought into a few recovery stocks in the US when the market took a beating last year. Nordstrom, ticker symbol JWN, I 3x my money on that one in just a few months, 2x on Simon Property Group, SPG, Boeing, American Airlines, MGM, and Wynn Hotels, just to name a few. Some of which I have sold and some of which I still own. At the end of the day, it also depends on your investing strategy. If you're really passive about your investments and you're buying stocks solely for the dividend income, I would choose to buy REITs, Real Estate Investment Trust, in Singapore because REITs tend to have a higher dividend yield and you're not subjected to that 30% withholding tax if you buy US dividend stocks as a non-citizen. If that's what I want to do with my money by getting that passive income, I'll choose to invest in the Singapore market over the US market. And speaking of dividend yield, many of the dividend stocks in Singapore are hovering at about 3-4% or so. The last time I checked, UOB has a dividend yield of 3-something%, and OCBC is at 2-something%. And in my opinion, that is really low because don't forget, we as Singaporeans have the option of CPFSA. Special accounts. If I had to choose between the CPFSA and any of the Singapore stocks in a regular market, which means it's even harder to find undervalued stocks, I will definitely choose the CPFSA. And why? The CPFSA gives you a guaranteed 4% interest a year, and if you factor in compound interest, it'll give you more consistency because the way dividends work is that they're based on the company's financials and performance. If it was a good year for the company, you'll get more in dividends, and if it was a rough year, don't be surprised when you get lesser dividends. And don't forget that the stock price is going to play a part as well. And if you want to invest in the US stock market, you'll have to keep yourself updated with news relating to the US market, especially when it comes to what the Feds are doing, current bond rates, interest rates, tax rates, all that kind of stuff. And recently, there was a sell-off in the market, right? That's largely due to fears that Biden is going to increase the capital gains tax rate to 40%. And during the Trump period, it was only at about 20%+. So that's almost doubled of what Trump was, and people got scared, so they started selling off in the market. So right now I'm trying to be strategic with my money, right? I'm always thinking about where I should put my money to get the highest possible returns with the least amount of risk. For me, there are always four plays in my portfolio. Value stocks, growth stocks, dividend stocks, and spec stocks. And because I'm so young and still have time on my side, I'm more focused towards growth stocks right now, which oftentimes are small cap companies. And because you have watched till this very part of the video, and I want to thank you, I'm gonna let you in on a little secret. One of the companies I'm buying into is called Planet 13. And maybe I'll make another video about why I'm buying this particular stock. So these are some of the reasons why I'm not investing my money into the Singapore stock market. And I just have to put it out there. Just because I'm not heavily invested into the Singapore stock market doesn't mean that you should avoid it. You have to know your investing personality and mentality and see which market is a better fit for you. Before you go, don't forget to destroy the like button, subscribe to my channel, and ring the bell icon so you get notified whenever I post a new video. And please follow me on my Instagram. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you again next time.